Good afternoon. The first item of business is a debate on motion number 374 in the name of Angela Constance on dignity, fairness and respect in disability benefits. And I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press their request to speak buttons now. And it gives me great pleasure to call on Jean Tomkins to give her opening... Jean Freeman. I'm marrying you off to the Conservative opposition spokesperson. It gives me great pleasure to call on the Minister to give her her opening debate speech in this Parliament. Ms. Freeman.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, if not for the marriage you just entered me into. Presiding Officer, I'm delighted to be here today opening a debate for the first time as Scotland's first Social Security Minister. I know this chamber has already debated and discussed these new powers, and I look forward to working with parliamentarians in the chamber and in the new committee. Our shared task is to lay the foundations of a social security system we can all be proud of. Given that this is also my first speech in the chamber, I hope you'll permit me to make two brief points. The first is, of course, to thank the voters of Carrick, Cumnock and Doon Valley, where I was born and raised, for the trust they have placed in me. And the second is to pay rightful and due tribute to both Adam Ingram, who served the constituency, the south of Scotland, and this Parliament so well in the past 17 years, and to Margaret Burgess, in her role in particular in setting up the first social security powers of this Parliament. Their example of putting people first, of hard work, and of total commitment to doing the best possible job is one I very much hope to emulate. I'm particularly pleased to have the opportunity to open this debate during Carers Week. This morning I visited Voices of Carers across Lothian, hearing firsthand about the important work that organisation does, and importantly, hearing direct from carers themselves about the challenges they face. I was able to let them know of this government's absolute commitment to make the best use we can of the new powers to recognise the contributions carers make to the quality of life of us all. These new powers, Presiding Officer, present us with an enormous opportunity, an opportunity to take a different path to the UK government and to harness the powers to our values so we support people and tackle inequalities, building a fairer society. In 2012, the UK government introduced its Welfare Reform Act. Julia Unwin, Chief Executive of the Joseph Rowntree Foundation, speaking about it a year later, said it is a system that is loathed by those who depend upon it, criticised by those who understand it, and with a public media discourse that demonises poor people and equates poverty with wickedness or hopelessness. Like many in this chamber, I have heard from disabled people worried and distressed by the cuts being imposed and by the way they are treated by the Tory welfare system. I have heard how the system that is supposed to help and support them is actually doing them harm. Delays and backlogs, lengthy, disjointed and complicated forms and process, inconsistency in assessment decisions. And driving all of that, calculated, planned UK government cuts to our lifeline support needed by so many of our most vulnerable citizens. Cuts in the name of austerity to provide a so-called fix for an economic crisis they did not create, but for which they are now paying a terrible price. UK government welfare spend is forecast to fall by 1.5% of GDP between 2015-16 and 2020-21, reaching at that point the lowest percentage level in 30 years. Systematic spending cuts at a UK level to housing benefit, incapacity benefit, employment state pensions, employment support allowance, and the introduction of a benefit cap. With 85% of benefits remaining at Westminster, we do not have the powers to address all of this unfairness. But we can and we will do better with the new powers that we will have. With a fairer, more transparent approach to social security, we intend to rebuild the trust that has been eroded and build in equality, fairness and respect. Social security is an investment to to support people. An investment in people and communities. There for any one of us when we need it and without blame or stigma. This government has already achieved a great deal with the powers we currently have. We have protected and invested in the Independent Living Fund, and in the self-directed support strategy and the legislation that underpins it, we have shown our commitment to enabling individuals, carers and their families to have flexibility, choice and control over the support services they receive. We have fully mitigated the effects of the bedroom tax, providing over £35 million in discretionary housing payments, protecting 72,000 households, 80% of which have a disabled adult, from the terrible anxiety that comes when you're told you need to pay more for your home because you simply have one bedroom too many. But with more than 500,000 people in Scotland receiving carer and disability benefits, our new powers give us the opportunity to do more. Presiding Officer, I now want to outline to the Chamber the steps we are taking to build a fairer and more transparent approach to disability benefits, making real the principles of dignity and respect. We have already committed to maintaining the level of disability benefits and making sure they will not be mean tested. We have heard many, many times that the assessment process is not working. Just last year, this Parliament was told of some harrowing experiences of disabled people through the work of the Welfare Reform Committee. And I'd like to take this opportunity to pay tribute to that committee and its work and the invaluable evidence and insight they provided. We were told of a process unable or unwilling to understand and take account of fluctuating health conditions, when a person can have good days and bad days. A process in a system that, as one woman who some days can't walk or brush her teeth has said, makes her feel like a nuisance and a fraud. How utterly appalling to live with a Tory system that makes someone feel like that. So we will reform the assessment procedures to ensure they work for people claiming disability benefits. The process of applying for and receiving benefits should be easy for everyone to understand, and people should be supported through the process. We will set clear timeframes for assessments, for decisions and appeals. We will ensure information is accessible for those who need it. If someone has an existing long-term condition that is unlikely to change, they should not be repeatedly reassessed. So we will stop the revolving door of assessments for those with long-term illnesses, disabilities or conditions and introduce longer-term awards. Awards based on individual circumstances and needs. And to provide more certainty and reduce stress to thousands of families whilst the transfer of benefits takes place, any child in receipt of disability living allowance will continue to receive that award to the age of 18 if they so wish. And we will do more. We will build into our system a consistent approach that treats every single person with compassion, with dignity, with fairness and with respect, and nothing less will be tolerated. Presiding Officer, research by Contact a Family has shown that higher heating and utility bills are the top extra costs for families with disabled children. In 2014, an estimated 34% of families with disabled children were going without heating. It is simply unacceptable that a parent is forced into making a choice about whether or not to heat their home. So that is why we will extend eligibility for winter fuel payment to families with children in receipt of the highest care component of the disability living allowance. Presiding Officer, I mentioned earlier the immense contribution made by Scotland's 745,000 unpaid adult carers and 44,000 young carers. Carers are motivated by love and compassion, and for many, caring is a rewarding and positive experience. But that doesn't mean it can't also have a negative impact on a carer's physical and mental well-being and their financial security. Some carers are forced into difficult choices between work and caring between studying and caring. Others take lower paid or less skilled jobs to fit in with their caring duties. And there are fewer opportunities for carers to do the simple things that we take for granted. Meeting friends, going to the cinema, time just for you. So, Presiding Officer, that is why it is crucial that we support carers to have a life alongside caring. It is unfair that support in the form of the carers' allowance is the lowest of all working age benefits. So we have committed to increasing it to the level of the job seekers' allowance, an additional £600 a year, an approximate 18% increase. And we have won the argument with the UK government to make sure that any carer who is in receipt of another low-income benefit, like income support, will remain entitled to that benefit as well. On May 25th, the First Minister announced in her speech on priorities for this government that we will ask our carer advisory groups for their views on how we might make progress on a young carer's allowance to provide extra support for young people with significant caring responsibilities. This suggestion came from the Green Party, and I'm delighted that we can show in practice our commitment as a government to listen and act on good ideas wherever they come from. I know that the Greens wanted to amend our motion, calling on us to consider this issue, and I would have welcomed that amendment as I welcome the idea. Presiding Officer, the devolution of social security powers and how we use them is one of the most complex tasks undertaken since the Scottish Parliament itself was re-established. It is a huge challenge and one that cannot be underestimated. It involves delivering a range of sometimes complex benefits worth around £2.7 billion. So our first priority will be to ensure a smooth transition for people receiving benefits, particularly disabled people and their carers. I'm confident that with shared effort, delivering these benefits safely and securely is a challenge we can meet. But an undertaking of this scale will take time to get right, not only in its technicalities, but in the approach we take to translate our founding principles into attitudes and behaviours which exemplify fairness, dignity, and respect. As we make progress over the next few years, we will engage in extensive consultation with this Parliament, with our partners, and importantly with our communities and the people who have direct experience of the benefits to be devolved, to make sure that we make the most of the opportunity to create a fair social security system. We have a huge opportunity to do things differently and better in Scotland. With that opportunity comes responsibility to make sure that what we deliver plays its part in tackling inequality and making life fairer for the people who claim disability benefits, for their carers and for their families. Together, we can build a stronger Scotland where every person has the opportunity to achieve their potential now and in future generations. I am pleased to move this motion in the Cabinet Secretary's name.
Thank you, Ms. Freeman. And I now call on Adam Tomkins to move the motion in his own name.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I move the amendment in my name. We join the Scottish Government, and indeed parties across the Chamber, in welcoming Carers Week. Carers make an invaluable contribution to our society and play a vital role in caring for family, friends and neighbours. And as the amendment in my name makes plain, we welcome the Scottish Government's commitment to implement our proposal to align carers' allowance with job seekers' allowance, which will support over 60,000 carers in Scotland. Yes.
Angela Constance.
I'm grateful to Mr. Tomkins for giving me. Could I just point out, as a matter of accuracy, that our commitment to increase carers' allowance was actually in our 2015 manifesto, and your commitment came 6 months later.
Mr. Tomkins.
The Cabinet Secretary makes an unfortunate intervention, it seems to me. There's been a lot of discussion in this Parliament so far of consensus. This is an area where we agree with the Scottish Government, and I would have thought that agreement would be welcome rather than criticised. I'd like to I'd like to thank the Scottish Campaign on Welfare Reform, Presiding Officer, for the event they held in the Parliament yesterday evening, which I attended, along with a number of other MSPs, including Oliver Mundell, Ivan McKee, Sandra White and Alison Johnston. And I'd like to thank Patrick Harvey for hosting the event. The Scottish Campaign for Welfare Reform, the Child Poverty Action Group, the Poverty Alliance, Inclusion Scotland and many other like organisations play an essential role, not only in Scottish public life, but specifically in Scottish parliamentary life, in, for example, the way they bring the stories of those who rely on our social security system directly to our attention as MSPs. And I'd like to express my personal thanks to all of those who spoke to us yesterday evening. I said in my speech in last week's debate on A Fairer Scotland that we want a social security system that supports the most vulnerable, that is focused on giving those who can work the opportunities and support to do so, and that is flexible and personalised. And I explained that we have two core aims.
Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank Mr. Tompkins for giving way. Mr. Tompkins has once again said supporting people to get into work. Why then is it that the Tory government have cut the work programme monies by 87%? Could he explain their reasoning for that and how that is going to get folk into work?
As the Minister knows, the work programme is one of those aspects of the United Kingdom social security system which is being devolved in full to this Parliament. And the fact is, whether the Scottish Government like it or not, that 152,000 disabled people are in employment in the United Kingdom now who were not in employment a year ago. I explained last week that we have two core aims when it comes to the benefits system. We want to be supportive of those who cannot work, and we want to be effective at getting those who are able to work into employment. And these aims apply both to social security generally and to the support we give to people with disabilities. Like everybody else in this chamber, we believe that the whole of our social security system should be operated so as to accord to everyone respect and dignity. There is no difference between Conservatives and anyone else in this Parliament on this essential starting point. Some members, however, speak about this as if respect and dignity are new ideas, unique to them, which they are bringing to the table for the first time. I've already given way to you once, Mr. Minister. I'll give way one more time in this speech to you, but after I've made a bit of progress with this point, if you'll forgive me. These ideas of respect and dignity in social security are not new, Presiding Officer. Indeed, they are already written into Scots social security law, as they have been written into administrative law in the United Kingdom since the 1960s. So when the Scottish ministers proclaim that they want a social security system based on dignity and respect, they are saying something we all agree with, they are saying nothing new, and they are saying nothing that is not already reflected and enshrined in our law. I'll give way to the Minister.
Kevin Stewart.
I thank Mr. Tompkins for giving way again, Presiding Officer. In which case, would Mr. Tompkins join with me in condemning those folks on his own benches at Westminster who talk of things like strivers and skivers? Does he feel that these kind of comments actually show dignity and respect for people?
I will choose my own words, Minister, and I am not using those words, and the Minister and everybody else in this Parliament can draw their own conclusions from the words I used rather than the words that anybody else uses in a different Parliament. I'm more interested in focusing on the social security powers that this Parliament has than in shouting from the rooftops about what happens 400 miles from here. Presiding Officer, working age benefits perform two different functions in the British welfare state. They support people with very low incomes, and they support people with additional needs. Most of the former will be rolled up into a new single benefit, universal credit. And for people with disabilities, the most important source of income support comes from Employment and Support Allowance, or ESA. The main sources of support for the extra costs associated with disability are disability living allowance, personal independence payments, and attendance allowance. All three of these are to be devolved in full. As I said in my speech last week, our approach to welfare, and indeed our approach to disability, is to say that the dignity of the pay packet is to be preferred to the indignity of a social security system that assumes that people are somehow not fit for work. This is an approach that is working as we see more and more people move off benefits and into work. And yet, at the same time, our financial support for people with disabilities has increased. It grew by £3 billion in the last Parliament, and in this Parliament, more than £50 billion will be spent on support for people with disabilities. There is still more to do, however. The disability employment gap remains too big, and that's why we are committed to halving it. We've had some success. The disability employment rate has increased from 39% to 44%. And welcome as this is, that rate is still some 43 percentage points below the employment rate for those who do not have a work-limiting health condition. And that's the gap that we want to close. Now, I want to say something about sanctions, about which there is a lot of understandable concern. First of all, it's important to understand that those who cannot work are not sanctioned. Claimants for ESA who are assessed not to be able to work are not required to undertake any activities in order to continue to receive the benefit. Only those who are able to undertake work-related activities are expected to do so. But even here, any requirement must be reasonable, taking into account the person's circumstances, and claimants cannot be required to apply for a job, to undertake work, or to submit to medical treatment. The sorts of requirements that may be imposed include activities such as skills training, job search support, drawing up a CV, or work experience. The Secretary of State for Work and Pensions accepted in August last year that improvements could be made to the practical operation of the scheme. It should be reformed, he said, to focus on what a claimant can do and the support they'll need, and not just on what they cannot do. And this is precisely the sort of change that can be affected by the move to universal credit, which is based throughout on a more personalised approach. Just a few weeks ago, Stephen Crabb, the new Work and Pensions Secretary, echoed these remarks when he said, and I quote, that I want to start a new conversation with disabled people, their representatives, healthcare professionals and employers. I want the welfare system to work better with the health and social care systems. And together, we can do so much better for disabled people. And these comments were welcomed by Liz Sace, the Chief Executive of Disability Rights UK. I've already given way three times, Mr. Cole-Hamilton. Shall I give way to you one more? Go on, then.
Alice Cole-Hamilton.
I'm very grateful to the member for giving way. It seems convenient to the member that he's proud of his colleagues at Westminster in certain parts of this speech, but not proud of his colleagues in Westminster at the rest of it. Can he clarify?
I'm not quoting colleagues at Westminster, Mr. Cole-Hamilton. I'm quoting the Secretary of State for Work and Pensions, and I'm quoting in particular the Chief Executive of Disability Rights UK, who agrees with the Secretary of State for Work and Pensions that we need practical, sensible and effective policies which help disabled people to be able to work if they can, enjoy family life and be part of the communities they live in, the same kinds of things that most people aspire to, disabled or not. That's the end of the quotation. I want now to turn in my closing few seconds to DLA and PIP. The personal independence payment introduced in the Welfare Reform Act 2012 is a non-means-tested, non-taxable benefit, payable whether the claimant is in or out of work to help with the extra costs arising from ill health or disability. It consists of two components, a mobility component and a daily living component. Entitlement is determined by a fair, objective assessment of individual need to ensure that support is targeted on those individuals whose health condition or impairment has the greatest impact on their day-to-day lives. In comparison with DLA, PIP targets support more closely on those in need, is more responsive as claimants' circumstances change, is based on a fairer, more transparent and consistent assessment of need, and is designed to be easier for claimants and their representatives to understand. Now, after some widely acknowledged difficulties of implementation in its first years, which resulted in unacceptable delays in some cases, the government has worked hard to reduce the backlog, and by the beginning of this year, the average clearance time for new PIP claims had fallen to 13 weeks and to 6 working days under the special rules for people with a terminal illness. And what should the Scottish Government do when PIP is devolved? PIP is based on the right principle. It is a significant improvement over the old DLA. It's designed to provide more personalised support to claimants and to target that support where it's needed most. It ensures that the support we give is suited to the needs of the individual, and that's a pretty good working definition, it seems to me, of dignity and respect. It's highly unlikely to be in the public interest for Scotland to go through yet another complex redesign of a system which is now starting to work well. So I close with 4 questions for Scottish ministers that perhaps the minister winding up for the government later on this afternoon could address. First, do they support our ambition to halve the disability employment gap? Second, when will they tell the Parliament what their proposed timetable is for the transfer of devolved welfare powers to Scotland? I wrote to the Cabinet Secretary a week ago about this matter, a letter which has not yet received acknowledgement, never mind response. Third, when powers over DLA and PIP are transferred, will the Scottish Government commit to maintaining the more targeted, responsive and consistent scheme we see in PIP, or are disabled people in Scotland going to face yet another costly social security reorganisation? And finally, what roles do ministers see local authorities and health boards playing in the administration of devolved social security for disabled people in Scotland? Thank you very much.
Thank you. I now call on Mark Griffin to speak to and move amendment in his name. Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The government motion in front of us today, bar a small but significant change, has the enthusiastic support of this side of the chamber. This Parliament will break new ground simply by setting the level of support for our carers. It will be unprecedented when we begin to take charge of the help provided to our disabled, and it will be historic when a social security bill is debated and, I hope, passed by members present here today. Groundbreaking, unprecedented and historic. These will be at the forefront of the message to the public for the changes in the coming months and years. Three words: dignity, fairness and respect have opened the door of the heroic possibilities which lie before us. But I think this is a time when politicians must tread carefully with our language. This is a time when we should and must be humbled by the challenge ahead of us, because it will be outcomes that matter. It will be substance on which we are judged. And in seeking to amend the government motion today, we seek to add substance, and I move the amendment in my name. It was an SNP manifesto commitment in 2015, and is a position which the Scottish Labour Party supports. It's a simple amendment, Presiding Officer, one which seeks to ensure that the financial assistance we provide keeps pace with the cost of living, one which starts a debate on the provision we will make for those who need a little extra help. A debate we begin by asking ourselves what kind of society we wish to see for our children and grandchildren, and what support is required to help create it. In this place, we have a majority that have campaigned and worked against cuts in mobility support. We've got politicians of all stripes who fought to build the work chances of our disabled. And we have the drive that keeps us awake at night wondering. Wondering how we can better help those who devote their lives to caring for our loved ones. Now, I'm grateful as a young man to those who have got us to where we are today. Those battles for recognition waged and won, prejudices challenged and beaten back, perceptions changed in our communities and workplaces, expectations raised, met and exceeded. And rightly, that expectation is building in our communities once again. Building in light of the challenges still faced by disabled people today, challenges which campaigners are fighting against every day, campaigners who I think will be watching closely how we approach these new powers. And it's an expectation not just for those directly affected by the powers we will hold, but for the country as a whole. An expectation of a system that doesn't tie up disabled people and carers in red tape. An expectation of a system that preserves people's independence and provides not just a safety net to allow them to survive, but a springboard to playing a full part in society. An expectation of a system which moves beyond the idea of social protection into a new dawn of social enhancement. An expectation of full social engagement, that's participating in education, employment, being able to volunteer, to care for your kids, and to simply enjoy and live your life. Now, the sentiment of the government motion today suggests that there is consensus to be found with those of us in the Labour movement, and that leaves options for the Minister who spoke so passionately this afternoon. And I ask her to look back at the history of the Labour movement and social security, a movement she knows well. So secure were the intellectual underpinnings of the welfare revolution, so self-evident are the cultural values of the movement which delivered it, and so enduring the settlement has been for half a century that I'm proud to stand here a Labour member today.
Jean Freeman.
Thank you. I'm pleased to advise the member that on behalf of the government, we do accept your amendment and indeed welcome it.
Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Minister. I'm grateful for that support, and I know disabled people around the country will be even more grateful for that support. And I think that support will be needed to create the changes that we need. And the choice is clear. She can look to those who have overseen the precipitous decline of government help, or those who seek to raise the bar still further. She can look to those who have marginalised our most vulnerable or those who seek to uplift them. She can look to those who restrict support for those facing challenges or those who seek to enhance it. Because we in the Labour movement have a long-standing belief that when the barriers block the path of the one, that path is blocked for all of us. That when one person is left behind, we cannot advance together. Now, if this government decides to bring about meaningful change, to build a system that will enhance the lives of our disabled citizens, that ensures our carers are provided the support they deserve, that reflects the language in the motion today of dignity, fairness and respect, she will have the support of that of the Labour movement. And I say to colleagues right across this chamber that the future of social security requires us to work together, not with our eyes clouded by political grievance, but with our focus firmly fixed on the expectation of a nation, an expectation which reflects a society we want to see, one based on dignity, fairness and respect. Because I think there are times in this country where we as individuals are going about our own business, enjoying the opportunities we've been blessed with. Because there are times in this country when as political parties and activists, we campaign tirelessly on issues we hold close to our hearts. And then there are times when we must come together, inspired by the dignity of the individual, united by a collective impulse to build and shape a shared future. We in the Labour movement believe that this is one of those times. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
We now move to open speeches of up to 6 minutes, and can I remind members that generally that means fewer than 6 minutes. So can I please call Gillian Martin to be followed by Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. With the welfare powers that are coming to Scotland, we have the opportunity not just to do things differently, but to learn from the mistakes of the UK government and how people in Scotland with disabilities are treated. I've spent the last week canvassing opinion from those who have disabilities in my constituency of Aberdeenshire East and those who care for them on the issues they face living in a rural setting. I'm very conscious of the fact that I have lived a life that has not had the type of challenges they face. And with a very low amount of MSPs in this chamber being themselves disabled, it's incumbent on all of us to do the same every time we debate how to improve the lives of those who are. Even better, let each of us as parties look at what we can do to get more people with disabilities access to the public positions that we're in. Then we can have first-hand experience as we debate these issues. Last week, we heard the Tory spokesperson on social security in this chamber lecture us on what he saw was the overuse of the word dignity when talking about welfare and disability. And one thing's for sure, to the people I spoke to last week in preparation for this debate, dignity was not a word to be used with disdain. It was something that every one of them wanted and rightly deserve, and something that's been sadly missing from their treatment by the UK's Department of Work and Pensions. In the emails I received from disabled constituents, the word dignity had top billing alongside the word independence. And this was more keenly felt for those in areas which did not have the public amenities that urban environments have. In the past, many of my constituents have had to travel for work capability assessments. Given where some may live, doing this independently is not an option, particularly where public transport isn't as frequent or as suitable as it is in urban areas. Many rely on their carers to get them to where they need to go. This week, as has been mentioned, is Carers Week, and I made a point of visiting the Young Carers Facility at Quarriers in Inverurie on Monday. During that visit, I spoke with some young carers, and I was struck by their stories, which added another dimension to the issues people with disabilities face, that of the impact on their children when a system is not sympathetic to a person's situation. A very substantial amount of adults with illness and disabilities are cared for by their children. When a disabled parent faces an appointment at a time or location that does not take into account the rural location in which they live, it impacts not just on them, but on their children. As we've all seen, if a person misses or even slightly late to an appointment under the UK system, sanctions have been swift and often impossible to overturn. In addition to this, when a young carer is involved, every assessment that must be attended could mean time off from school. And of course, these young people are not of driving age and must rely on public transport or assistance from a voluntary support group or a family friend. What we've the opportunity to do is we manage the welfare powers coming to this government is use 21st century technology to make lives easier for people with disabilities. A cessation of the unnecessary and often time-consuming visits to an urban location for assessments would make a great deal of difference to people with disabilities in rural areas and their carers. As we tackle the connectivity issues around rural areas, which is in this programme for government, let's also consider how we serve the disabled in rural locations for whom travel is an issue. Let's consider how we use technology to help young carers manage their responsibilities. And as a final point, reaching across to the portfolio of education and the subject of reducing the attainment gap, which is a key priority of this government, what we do in terms of support for young carers at a welfare level can also support their achievements at school and progression into post-school education. Getting welfare right can make the difference between rural young carers accessing their right to further and higher education and making the onward journey to contributing to Scotland's economy. And to this end, it's not only right that young carers do not lose the, to this end, it is also right that young carers do not lose their allowances if they access further and higher education as they did under the UK system, even if that was full-time distance learning like the Open University. We have the opportunity to make our disabled citizens and the families who care for them not only reach their potential, but to live a life that is supported and not made more difficult by a system along the lines of the UK one they have been subjected to in the past. And I hope that before long, all welfare powers are devolved to this place so that we can take full responsibility and have fairness across the board.
I call on Jeremy Balfour to be followed by Bob Dorris.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's a great honour to be elected to this Parliament. It's even a greater honour to be elected to represent the area that I was born in and have spent most of my life in. Lothians is a great place to live, work, play and study. But the region faces challenges ahead, and I will seek to represent and lobby on behalf of all my constituents who have put me here for this five-year term. Ruth Davidson and the Conservatives appealed to a wide audience during the last campaign. The constituency that I thought was North Midlothian and Musselburgh, and we saw the Conservative vote go up by 9% in my area. Many people that I spoke to as I went door to door said to me they were voting Conservative for the first time because they were simply disillusioned with Labour and they wanted to hold this government to account. And that's what I and my colleagues will do over these next 5 years. Can I thank a number of people, previous members, Gavin Brown and Cameron Buchanan, and also to put on record my gratitude to David McCletchy, who sadly passed away during my last term. I was in politics from my university days, and David was a model and a role model on how you should conduct yourself. I want to thank my family for their support and also put on record my thanks to NHS Lothian. During the campaign, I sadly got a heart problem and ended up spending 6 days in the Royal Infirmary, where I had superb care, and I thank them and all who helped me through that period. And finally, can I thank the staff here, Presiding Officer, for the welcome and the way that they've made us all feel as new members. Presiding Officer, I was told when I entered this place I would have to make difficult decisions and sometimes compromise. I didn't understand that that would happen so early on in my time as an MSP. Only 6 days after being elected, Hibs won the Cup. And on a Monday, somebody put down a motion asking us to congratulate Hibs for winning the Cup. As a long life supporter of Hearts, I both had a difficult decision and a compromise as I signed that motion. If I may now turn to the debate this afternoon. I fully support the amendment put down by my colleague. I should declare two interests, presiding officer, at this stage. For 22 years, up until the 5th of May, I worked as a disabled member on tribunals that heard DLA and PIP cases. And secondly, I am personally in receipt of PIP and previously DLA. I am pleased that these powers have been devolved to this Parliament, and I hope the Scottish Government will take these powers on as soon as possible so that we can hold them accountable and then move on from where we are. The danger is that we keep looking back and blaming others. The powers are there, let's take them and move forward. But as we move forward, let's not just change for change's sake. Clearly, PIP was a change for many people. Reassessment, tribunals, filling out forms. And to unsettle them with yet more change for the sake of it would be unhelpful for them and their families. So yes, where alterations and changes need to take place, let's do that. But let's make sure we don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. Can I concentrate just very briefly on two areas of PIP? I think it has bedded down and is working well. I think the majority of people are better off than they were under DLA. The beauty of PIP is that it focuses not on a diagnosis, not on a disability, but it focuses on what is the individual's need and how can that be met. There are two areas I think we do need to look at going forward. Certain disabilities, because of their nature, do seem to be struggling to get the new PIP. An example of this is people that have epilepsy, which is uncontrolled and can have a devastating effect on people's lives. Because of a 50% rule, sometimes they miss out, and I think it would be worth the government and this parliament looking at that afresh. The second area is in regard to appliances and how we define what an appliance is. I don't know how many of you put your socks or tights on by sitting on the bed this morning. Under the interpretation by the upper tribunal's cases, that would be seen as an aid and an appliance. And that seems to me a far too broad term and not what people expected. And so I think we do need to look at terms. Finally, presiding officer, we all agree we need disability benefits, but they should be focused on the individual and they should always be there to help that person and their family be all that they can be and flourish and experience life as much as possible, and not as sometimes benefit is seen as to hold you back and not allow you to be the person that you are meant to be. Thank you very much.
I call now Bob Dorris to be followed by Johan Lamont.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. In terms of speaking this debate in relation to dignity and respect for those on disability benefits, I actually want to refer to a constituent of mine who came along to Postle Park Library where I hold a parliamentary advice surgery just last Saturday. I'd like to thank her for her permission to use her story and to illustrate just why it's so vital that as many welfare and social security powers sit in our Scottish Parliament, and we have to do far better than a UK Tory government who have demonised and victimised some of their most vulnerable citizens. My constituent received contaminated blood in 1977 during a surgical procedure. But this didn't come to light until the year 2000, when my constituent was diagnosed with chronic hepatitis C and cirrhosis of the liver. This has a significant impact on her health, and she won't recover. However, ATOS and the DWP continue to insist that she repeatedly reassessed. Presiding Officer, my constituent was a victim when she received contaminated blood. She felt stigmatised when her diagnosis was confirmed, and now she feels targeted and victimised once more each and every time she's required to be reassessed for DLA. My constituent won't recover, I've already said. She won't get better. And she's campaigned for answers and justice on a variety of issues, understandably, for many years. So why has the UK government continued to require repeated reassessments? There's no way to turn the clock back to pre-1977 when she was a victim of contaminated blood. Thank heavens, actually, then, that our Scottish government has signalled a different way of treating some of our most vulnerable citizens. I look forward to the use of longer-term awards and indeed lifetime awards in certain circumstances for DLA and PIP for some of our most vulnerable citizens, for my constituent that I met in Postle Park Library on Saturday. In doing this, Minister, can I ask that specific consideration is therefore given to those that find themselves in my constituents' circumstances, not just for their physical well-being, but for their emotional well-being, feeling repeatedly victimised and traumatised every single time a reassessment is required. Now, for the purposes of time constraints, I won't mention her recent experience with ATOS, which was why she was at my surgery, and I found out the overall story. But needless to say, the organisation has never been fit for purpose, and there continues to be significant problems there. I'd like to actually turn now to a local organisation within my Maryhill and Springburn constituency called North Kelvin Sports. It's a wonderful organisation, runs nine young people's football teams across the constituency, provides an amazing social benefit. They also run a variety of courses in relation to tackling sectarianism issues and a variety of other social issues within North Glasgow and beyond. And they ran a course called Off the Bench. It was funded by Awards for All, and it hoped to encourage inactive individuals, particularly hoping to encourage those who have been released from prison, those recovering from addiction, and those who are long-term unemployed, targeting in a positive way, if you like, ESA claimants. Job Centre Plus locally was also very enthusiastic. They were trying to develop a real partnership approach. I have to say the off-the-bench initiative wasn't successful. The main barrier was the poor uptake of volunteers to go and participate on that course, because many of them were terrified that participation in the off-the-bench course would be used as a Trojan horse to withdraw their benefits. So there was an example of good, honest, decent people within Job Centre Plus at a local level trying to work in partnership with a community organisation, but the system just wouldn't allow it. Now, I mention that because we won't have powers over that in this Parliament when these powers, the limited powers, do come here. Only 15% of all social security and welfare payments will come to this place. That's not the limit of my ambition. We have to transform the lives, not just of that lady that was at Postle Park Library, where we will get the powers to help her. We have to get the powers to this Parliament to transform the lives of the people who could have benefited from that off-the-bench course in a productive way. But the system just didn't allow it, because the UK system just isn't flexible enough to allow it. I want to say one final thing on a more personalised level. Some of you will know in this place that I actually lost my father on election day. He passed away on election day. And he claimed disability benefits for a significant part of his life. But when I was younger, one of the main concerns I had was that my father was sometimes worried to be well, because the system just didn't support you if you thought you might be able to do a little bit more. As soon as the UK government or DWP gets a whiff that you might be able to do a little bit more, with a fluctuating health condition, you could be in bed all the next day when you try to do a little bit more. It sanctions you, it withdraws your benefit, and it dehumanises you, and it's not fit for purpose. I'm glad some of the limited powers are coming to this Parliament, and I have no doubt the Scottish Government will do just the right thing.
I now call Joanne Lamont to be followed by Alison Johnson.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And it is fitting that it is in Carers Week that we are continuing this debate about how we ensure there is dignity and respect in our welfare system. Carers in particular have punched well above their weight in this Parliament since it was created, and I think now we have to make again a commitment that we give them more than warm words in return, that our decisions will make a difference to their lives rather than simply being a question of us sharing their pain. And I know that respect and care for carers is felt right across the Parliament, but I think it's a particular challenge that we should rise to over the next period. I think we should thank disability groups for their energy, and they deserve that they then, as a consequence, shape political debate, policy, and critically the spending choices in this Parliament. I want to thank Inclusion Scotland, Glasgow Disability Alliance, Disability Agenda Scotland, all of whom and more were active during the election campaign in ensuring the issues of people with disabilities were highlighted. But of course, listening to campaigning groups is not just for the election trail, but it should be at the centre and focus of what we do now with the powers that we have. I have to say that much of the debate on social security and the impact of welfare changes has been profoundly damaged by the facile and cruel division of our population into workers and shirkers, by people whose education and income should have meant a great deal better analysis. It is a corrosive characterisation of our society, and one that damages and stigmatises and denies the reality of the inequality and injustice faced by all too many disabled people, not just in Scotland, but right across the United Kingdom. It is right to ensure that people who cannot work are treated with dignity and respect and are supported to live as fulfilled a life as possible. That is part of being a decent society. And I want to pay my full part, and I know my party does too, in developing and funding these supports rather than people having to fight for them throughout their lives. It is an ongoing feature of the lives of disabled people and their carers, not just that their entitlements are minimal, but even those entitlements have to be fought for against a system that seems to want to deny them. And given that over 50% of welfare reform falls on the shoulders of disabled people, it is understandable that much of the debate that we are having is about the benefit system. I think there is a danger, not intended by any of us, that in that debate and focusing on benefits, we reinforce a model of helplessness and hopelessness of disabled people, denying the people, as Bob Doris had said, the opportunity to do a little better because they will suffer for it. And all that we can do to help disabled people is to talk about benefits. My party has always sought to be the party of full employment. I am old enough to remember that my mother's generation fought for the right to work because of the independence it brought. It is right that people with disabilities should have the right to work too. And we have to challenge the massive injustice to people with disabilities, that they are denied the right to work where they can to achieve their potential and fulfil their ambition. The statistics are stark. Young disabled people up to 3 times more likely than their non-disabled peers not to be in education, employment or training. Disabled people are more than twice as likely as non-disabled people to have no qualifications. Less than half of working age disabled are in employment compared to 80% of non-disabled people. So this is the greater scandal at our hand. We build barriers against employment of disabled people and then denounce and punish them for not working. That is shameful. This is an issue of equality and fairness, but it's also an economic issue. And it is my contention, therefore, that social security and the debate around that has to be seen not just in investment in benefits, which is must be, but should include investment in action to overcome the barriers faced by people with disabilities. And I believe that the challenge for the government is to ensure that they mainstream their thinking on benefits and the needs of disabled people into their employment strategies too. It cannot be right that in 2012-2013, according to Inclusion Scotland, just 63 out of 25,691 modern apprenticeships went to young disabled people. So when we talk about the question of fairness and dignity, it has to be about employment opportunity too. What is the government going to do in its business pledge to expect employers to provide opportunities for people with disabilities? In public procurement, are we asking that those who seek the benefits of the public purse to provide more employment opportunities for people with disabilities? We know the Scottish Government policy is that every public body should have at least one contract with a supported business, and I'd welcome an update on that. But can we do more in terms of ensuring that the reservation of contracts does create further opportunities for people with disabilities? What is our thinking around employment and skills to recognise the barriers of people with disabilities? What are we doing around stigma? What are we saying about the whole question of social care? And I must underline to the government the importance of the issue of the funding of local government in this regard. Small bits of money that make it possible for people to secure and maintain their work. That is not the minimal impact of a government choice, but can be the difference between a fulfilled life and one not fulfilled by too many in our communities. And in conclusion, fundamentally this, the question we have to address, we have powers, not them all, how do we use them and how do we focus them? But how can we increase resources by a fairer taxation system, or if not that, a fairer redistribution of what resources exist? I am sure there are many across this chamber will agree with me. This is not special pleading for us to do a favour to people with disabilities, but this is to provide them with a level playing field, a field that currently is tipped very much against them. And I look forward to working with the government in ensuring that it's thinking not just on benefits, but the rights of disabled people, employment, will be at the centre of the work that they do.
Alison Johnson, to be followed by Sandra White.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. With a range of new powers being devolved by the New Scotland Act, this session of Parliament has the potential to be the most transformative since the first, back in 1999. In particular, the transfer of power over some aspects of social security can enable us to give everyone in Scotland the basic security that we all deserve. And it couldn't come a moment too soon. Those of us at last night's Scottish Campaign on Welfare Reform meeting heard from Ryan, who told us that disabled people were three times as likely to be sanctioned as they were to be found a job. And this is while a recent DWP-backed project found that every pound cut from benefits reduces the likelihood of participants returning to work by 2%. Recent years have seen an unprecedented attack on the support relied upon by those who need help most. And the Centre for Welfare Reform estimates that disabled people had almost 30% of the cuts targeted upon them between 2010 and 2015. And the figures for the most severely disabled are even worse. And a wealth of research into cuts to disability benefits has shown that the recent changes have made it less, not more likely, that claimants will get into work. The current benefit system not only lacks the financial support people need, but people feel lost and powerless in a system that sometimes seems determined to defeat them. It's not a supportive system, it sometimes feels like an ordeal. Too many people face appeals that drag on for months, their files are lost, they're not able to speak to anyone with the power to help them. So we know that this causes a huge amount of stress to claimants, and it can leave them too without the basics of life. The Trussell Trust estimate that benefit delays and changes, many of them avoidable errors in benefits delivery, comprised 44% of all referrals to food banks. Presiding Officer, we must do better, and with the new powers off the Parliament, we can do better. Scottish Greens believe now is the time to radically refound the benefit system in Scotland, to begin the necessary culture change. And these new powers offer us a chance to chart a different course to that pursued by Westminster. We can have a social security system that does just that, provides security. But not just security of income, but a set of clear, defined rights that people in need can rely on and not feel they're subject to the whims of the benefit authorities. And that's why my amendment, which wasn't selected today, asked Parliament to recognise that rights, as well as respect and dignity, should be at the core of social security. And I'd like to move on to how we can use the new powers to help Scotland's young carers in particular. We all agree that unpaid care work is a hugely valuable contribution to our society. 3 out of 5 of us will become carers at some stage in our lives, and 1 in 10 of us is already fulfilling some sort of caring role. There are, as we've heard, around 745,000 carers in Scotland, and 44,000 of these are young carers under the age of 16, with some studies putting the figures as high as 100,000, 1 in 10 of the school-age population. And Gillian Martin was right to point out that supporting these young people is an important part of closing the attainment gap. Unpaid care in Scotland has an estimated total value of £10.3 billion, and this means that even at a conservative estimate, young carers provide free care worth over £600 million a year. Now, carers of all ages face huge challenges. A third are struggling to pay utility bills, 47% have been in debt, half are struggling to make ends meet, cutting back on food and heating as a result. But young carers face additional challenges. Most are caring for someone with a physical health problem, but they're often also giving emotional as well as practical and personal care. One in 10 are caring for more than one person, and around 50% are caring for more than 10 hours. And all of this at age 12, the average age for a young carer. Clearly then, carers of all ages, and young carers in particular, both need and deserve better support. And now we have the opportunity. The new Scotland Act devolves power over carers' allowance, and so we can now use the benefits system to show that we value unpaid care. I was proud to stand on a manifesto that put recognising and valuing care work front and centre. We called for a significant increase in the carer's allowance to £93.15 a week, and also echoing a call made by members of the Scottish Youth Parliament in a petition to Parliament 3 years ago for a young carer's grant to recognise the care work that so many young carers, young people do every day. MYSP Lauren King spoke about the difficulty that young carers have in accessing financial support, due in part to the fact that carers under the age of 16 can't access carer's allowance. And Scottish Greens welcome the progress made by the Scottish Government's Getting It Right for Young Carers strategy. But let's act now to make sure that young carers are further protected from poverty. So I was pleased to hear the Government pick up on our Green Manifesto commitment to a young carer's allowance, and I welcome the Minister's positive and supportive words this afternoon, and I'd warmly welcome the opportunity to work with the Minister and the Government on developing this. Presiding Officer, this Parliament is now presented with both the chance and the imperative to create a new, fairer, empowering and rights-based social security system, to reduce the increasingly unfair and dysfunctional system that has resulted from Westminster welfare reforms. The Scottish Greens welcome the moves towards this that the Scottish Government has made so far, and we look forward to working across the Chamber to achieve this vision. Finally, Presiding Officer, young Ryan, who spoke so eloquently at last night's meeting, said that the Scottish Parliament has a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to design disability benefits that work. Let's not waste it. I agree wholeheartedly with him. Thank you.
Can I remind members that when people take over the allotted time, it penalises their colleagues. So can I have some brevity from now on, please? Sandra White, followed by Liam Kerr.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I welcome the Minister to her new role and new post, and I'm sure she'll enjoy the post very much. And as a member of the new Social Security Committee, I look forward to working along with the Minister and the Cabinet Secretary also. I want to start off with a quote from Sam H. And the first thing that Sam H says is, the problem. The problem is the current Social Security system is absolutely failing people with mental health problems. They cite from their research, 98% of respondents from mental health has suffered due to welfare reform. 79% of service users had reduced income. 48% of service users were less able to pursue leisure and social activities. And really startling and very horrific of all, 6 suicide interventions were undertaken during the period of the research that Sam H made into welfare cuts. Absolutely astounding, and we should all be ashamed that something like that happened on anybody's watch hours or anyone else. But if I could turn, Presiding Officer, to the Scottish Government motion, and in particular the commitment to involve carers, disabled groups and representatives of those groups in the development of the Scottish benefit system, I really believe that this is tremendously important. Alison Johnson mentioned the meeting last night, and this came across last night, that people were not being involved, things weren't being transparent enough, and they didn't know what the next step was. And I think that's a really important aspect of this new system that is coming to the Scottish Parliament. Really, it goes to the heart of any decisions which will have an impact, as we all know, on the daily lives of the people who access benefits as well. And as the motion states, dignity, fairness and respect goes to the very heart of what we are doing here in this Parliament and the Social Security system, and commitment which we make to the people of Scotland in this Parliament, and if recollection is right or correct, I believe this recommendation was also one of the Christie Commission's recommendations, which we have also adopted, and I think that's very, very important. Now, certainly from my own experience of constituency cases, I'm sure it's the same from everyone here, benefits, cuts in benefits, PIP, personal independent payments, have been raised more and more with myself. When you go out to visit constituents, I was at Flourish House last Monday, PIP was raised on numerous occasions. Basically, people were presenting themselves to be told that they no longer were able to actually access or meet the criteria for any payments. Now, the work that's been done by agencies to help people with mental health problems to recover or appear, to lead a normal life was absolutely cut back by the fact that they appear at these panels and they are told during the assessment they don't meet the criteria and therefore everything's fine. That has a devastating effect on these people and the agents that work with them, particularly in Flourish House, who I met a number of them. All the good work they've done, it sends them back. And as I'd mentioned with Sam H, other problems come forward with that in particular as well. You know, the valuable work that they carry out with people with disabilities and mental health problems, it basically is stopped by what happens when they go to these panels. And that's why I think it's very, very important that we're looking at the assessment procedures, which will be reformed to stop this revolving door of assessments and appeals, which really does directly contribute to increased stress and anxiety amongst people who really are left in limbo and don't know where else to go. The introduction, I think Bob Doris mentions this, of long-term awards for existing long-term conditions is another policy which I really very much welcome. And I would hope that all parties, regardless of the politics in this chamber, would support these proposals. And I do note that the Scottish Conservatives have put in their amendment about working collaboratively with other parties. And I would like to point out to Mr. Tompkins that I appreciate that, but also I think it would be more helpful if it actually the truth was told that these cuts are coming from the Conservative Party in Westminster. And really, I would appeal or urge the Scottish Conservatives in this Parliament to speak to their Tory government in Westminster that no more cuts are forthcoming for anyone, not just in Scotland, but throughout the UK. People have had enough, and basically the stats that I said from Sam H about people attempting to commit suicide is something that's shameful, and I would hope you would take up that as a genuine offer to speak to your counterparts there. I see I'm running out of time, Presiding Officer. I'd just like to finish with a quote from Enable, which shows we really need to do something, and we will in the Scottish Parliament. First quote is, claiming DLA is difficult, the forms are horrendous, and it's upsetting having to justify every bit of support your child needs and having to write in minute detail exactly what's wrong with your child. Another quote, someone from the local authority came in to fill in the DLA form. She was very insensitive and handed me a leaflet and says, just tick these boxes. Now, these are the things that we have to make sure does not happen in the Scottish social security system. We owe that to the people. And I'm sure if we all work together, we'll be able to make sure and ensure that that does happen. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Liam Kerr, followed by George Adam.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. There are three contributions that I wish to make in support of our amendment to this motion. The first is a caution. This is an important debate. Powers will be devolved to this legislature, which give unprecedented ability to provide disability benefits in particular. In receiving these powers, I echo Sandra White's point. We have an opportunity to look forward, to work collaboratively, using the best abilities of all parties to ensure fairness to all stakeholders. But this can only be achieved if we ensure that none of us falls into the basic error of demonising, to use Mr. Doris's word, any of the contributors to this debate or the wider ongoing discussions. It would be very easy in a debate such as this to constantly hark back in particular to Westminster policies, evil Tories. But to do so would be as unconstructive as it would be unproductive. I say to Jean Freeman, I'm... Yes, I will.
Sandra White.
I thank you, the member, for taking the intervention. I don't think I mentioned demonising anyone, but what I would ask, do you actually think that what happened from Westminster in cutting the monies to disability claimants was the right thing to do?
Liam Kerr.
It's gone up, is my understanding, and we've devolved it. And if you allow me to develop the point, Sandra White will allow me to develop the point, then she will hear some more on that. I was encouraged to hear Jean Freeman at the outset talking about listening and act on good ideas wherever they come from. Well, let's not alienate anyone without reason on this. If Scotland chooses to take a different path to that of the rest of the UK, that will be its prerogative. So let's look forward and decide what is that best path without unedifying attacks which don't do anything to move the debate forward. Yes.
Joanne Lamont.
I mean, I recognise the responsibility of this chamber to take the powers that exist and to do the very best and build consensus, but would you agree with me that some of your colleagues who defined this debate as being between shirkers and workers was profoundly unhelpful, and it should be language that would be left elsewhere?
Liam Kerr.
Nobody has used those terms in this chamber from these benches. And what I would say to Joanne Lamont is, this is a new term, this is a new election, these are new people. We come at it with our own... I'm afraid I just can't. I've taken two and I have 6 minutes. Let's look at what underpins the amendment proposed from these benches. The implementation of a disability benefit system for the vulnerable, the distressed, the disabled, which is empowering, facilitates participation, and which recognises everyone's contribution and value to society, is one which we can all support. We can all agree that any social security system should provide a safety net with the ultimate ethos, to use Citizens Advice Scotland's wording, of a more equally and socially just society, which in practice I would suggest means enabling those who require disability benefits to achieve an appropriate standard of living whilst promoting independence, participation and equality. Now, clearly Scotland cannot simply offer benefits to anyone that demands them. And if we accept that as a premise, then it also has to be accepted that there is a line to be drawn, beyond which people do not have an entitlement. On one side of the line, a person is in the category disabled and will receive benefits. On the other, they are not in the category and do not. Defining that line will be one of the great challenges, and it is a line which must be very carefully drawn and only done after objective, reasoned scrutiny and investigation. And if you are with me that there has to be a line, then you must also agree that it's vital that appropriate experts make the assessment of which side of that line an individual falls, and that they use objective, clear, unambiguous criteria applied in a manner that fully respects the individuals involved and ensures all stakeholders, including those being assessed, have confidence in the system. And we should not be restricted in deciding who and from which professions are best placed to make that assessment or the process involved in doing it. Now, some in this chamber have made clear they feel the UK government system is too harsh or makes inappropriate judgments, and I do not challenge the strength of their feeling. But we have an opportunity to design a system that is bespoke to Scotland, and simply pointing at the UK government and saying, you've got it wrong, will do nothing to advance this opportunity. Quite the contrary, whatever this chamber's view of the UK government system, there are lessons to be learned. As Adam Tomkins said at the outset, Jeremy Balfour supported, and I note the Child Poverty Action Group have accepted, the personal independence payment is based on the right principles, improved on a disability living allowance system, and provides support more geared to the needs of the individual. It is unlikely to be in the public interest for Scotland to go through a comprehensive redesign of the system for political expediency. That will be the task of this Parliament, to draw the line appropriately, following objective debate and selecting appropriate experts. Which leads to my final point. There is a fundamental risk of category error in any debate such as this, insofar as it is very easy to categorise a group as the disabled and leave it at that. What our amendment makes clear is that the category person in receipt of disability benefits is not fixed, nor is membership of that category an end in itself, with the person remaining in that group or being ascribed other characteristics automatically. A disability and/or being in receipt of a disability benefit is not and should not be a barrier to work. Many people in receipt of disability benefits cannot work and must not be stigmatised or suffer any prejudice for that reality. But many can, want to, and need our support to get into work.
The
Could
amendment,
you close now, please?
Of course. In conclusion, we look forward to the powers over disability benefit coming to this Parliament, and this party will play its part in designing a system that is targeted, appropriate and fair.
You really must close now, Mr.
Kerr. Commend the amendment to the Chamber.
George Adam, followed by Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I take on board much of what all the members in the Chamber have taken on today, and I take on board the Tories are wanting to talk about how we can deal with the powers that we now have. But they can't get away from the fact, no matter how you try to dress it up, the heartache that has been caused in communities throughout Scotland with their so-called welfare reforms. You cannot just say, this is day one, this is the new beginning. You have to take responsibility for some of the things that the Tories have done. Gladly, Mr. Tomkin.
Will the member accept that disability living allowance and PIP have gone up every year since the Conservatives became the government in 2010?
George Adam.
What I will accept, Mr. Tomkin, is the fact that you have put heartache families through disability tests to make sure that they actually have to prove how disabled they are. You've had people who have not assessed their actual condition and have failed their PIP, and 80% in appeal end up getting it anyway. You've made an absolute farce of the situation, so you can't dress it up and try and kid on that you are the good guys in this whole scenario. The fact that respect for individuals is at the very heart of everything the Scottish Government intends to do with disability benefits will be a welcome change to many of the people and families living with disabilities. Currently, the Westminster Tory Government has treated disabled people with no respect, offering them no dignity and making them feel that their disability is their fault. Whether it be the attacks by the Westminster Conservative Government on their benefits, the very money that is keeping them and their families, giving them the opportunity to get by. Many members will be aware I work with Renfrewshire Access Panel, and I'm the patron of the Scottish Disability Equality Forum. And through this work, I've seen the heartache and devastation caused by the Tory administration in Westminster. It is only right that this Scottish Government challenges itself with treating disabled people with dignity and respect. As this is Carers Week, I should declare interest as a carer, Presiding Officer. Many of you will know my wife Stacey and I am her primary carer. Although, Presiding Officer, she's done not a bad job in the past 20 years keeping me in the straight and narrow. But today is our wedding anniversary, and I'd like to use our 20th wedding anniversary, and I'd like to use our example of dealing with multiple sclerosis and the challenges that's had. I've seen how a disability can affect someone in their life, from a young woman walking down the aisle 20 years ago to now. If she probably did that, Mr. Tomkin, she'd probably fail her PIP assessment, which would probably ensure that a woman now who has to adapt how she lives her life to deal with her disability. Now, Scotland is full of these stories, families struggling to deal with life's many challenges, with the added disadvantage of also dealing with lifelong conditions. When we work with these families in their time of need, we need to ensure that the state does not become one of their extra problems. That is what exactly is happening at the moment with the so-called Tory welfare reform. Presiding Officer, Conservative double talk for making the poor and disabled is actually a case of just actually making them poorer and less able. At this point, Presiding Officer, I'd like to talk about and take this opportunity to discuss two elements of the debate that are extremely important to me: the role of carers and living with long-term conditions. As I've stated previously, I am Stacey's primary carer, but I'm lucky. I'm lucky enough to have the support of a family who can actually make sure that I can go out and try and achieve everything for our own family. But others don't have that opportunity. Others don't have that support. And we need to ensure, as a government, that we can offer that type of support for carers and make sure that they get that support and opportunity to be able to do that. Many carers can't work. Many carers can't work. The sole earners, they are the sole earners, but they can't work because they have so much to do with their caring work as well. So an MS is obviously a condition that I have to live with. And when I say I have to live with it, I have to live with Stacey dealing with MS, and she supports me and her family supports us to make sure that we can deal with that. But the MS Society in Scotland recently asked us all to make welfare make sense. And that's not a strange request, because when you look at the current system, it does not help long-term conditions like multiple sclerosis. We need to find a way to ensure that we can make that easier. And one of the things that they came up with was the welfare system in Scotland must must not threaten the financial security of people affected by MAS through unmanageable assessment process and short-term awards, but instead show how greater understanding of the complexity of their condition. We must take into account the conditions that individuals have and what they have to deal with in that case as well. And the key findings of a recent MS Scotland survey found that most people who are diagnosed with MS happens between 20 and 30 years old. Key years working life, key years in your educational life. 80% of them with MS end up not working within 15 years of actually being diagnosed. That shows you the challenges that we have with many other long-term conditions. And it's good that the Scottish Government continue to talk about respect and dignity during this, this debate. But as someone once said, don't count the days, let's make the days count. Let's make sure we get this right and support families throughout Scotland who are having to deal with long-term conditions and disabilities.
Following the next speech, open contributions must be restricted to 5 minutes. I'm sorry about that. Mr. Cole Hamilton, you have 6 minutes.
Thank you,
Presiding Officer. Followed by Marie Todd. Sorry, Mr. Cole Hamilton.
That's quite all right. Thank you, Presiding Officer. During my first speech to this chamber, I talked during the Europe debate about my delight at the consensus forged across the benches and across the parties on that particular issue. And today I rise to deliver a speech in such a vein. Throughout the election campaign, the Liberal Democrats fought on common ground with both the government benches, the Labour Party and the Greens on the need to improve the lives and the quality of support available to families affected by disability in this country. So I am delighted that the government have brought this motion before the chamber today. We will be supporting it as we will be supporting the Labour amendment. We meet at the height of Carers Week, and many people have rightly made reference to that, and it is right that they should do so, because the army of carers that we rely on in our society are the unsung heroes of the care sector. Without their support, without the love that we arguably as a country exploit, then the cost to the care sector would be doubled many, many times over. They are, in many cases, just one late night hospital dash away from surrender, but because they love their families, they keep going and they keep going. And I think that I would like to make special reference, as has been done so by other members today, to the needs of young carers, because we often forget that young carers are more than just young carers. They're children, they're young people as well. They care for a sibling or a parent who have profound disabilities, but they still have to sit exams. They still have to have a meaningful childhood. And it is incumbent upon us and the powers that we now have at our disposal to ensure that they have as normal and as happy a childhood as possible. Public policy is a vehicle through which we can extend help and comfort, not just to those affected by disability, but by those people around them. So my remarks will focus on both of those groups in the time I have, and I want to speak to three particular things. Firstly, getting help at the point of need. Secondly, ensuring that our society is geared up and that we remove any systemic or bureaucratic barriers whenever we find them. And finally, to ensure that political rhetoric is matched by reality. Now, in many cases, disability, as we know, is first manifest in early childhood or infancy and detected then as well. It's often a terrible and life-changing moment for families when they realise that they will be forever affected by this particular disability. But detection is not always immediate and it is not always visible. And I spoke in the Ferris Scotland case debate of the case of my constituent who has been fighting for the best part of a year for her daughter to get a diagnosis on the autistic spectrum in terms of the waiting list that she has had to contend with for child and adolescent mental health. Having that barrier is an immediate problem in terms of getting people to the starting line of state support. And again, whilst we can all agree on what a dignified and wholly humane system of Scottish social security should look like, we absolutely need to look at the peripheral barriers that stop people getting to those starting lines in the first place. Diagnosis is not the only barrier to getting people state support. Awareness is a big problem as well. When I was working for a children's charity which specialises in delivering service for families affected by disability, I met a family who got a diagnosis at birth about a lifelong condition their daughter would have to contend with. It was only at the two-year checkup of their daughter, when they met a family whose child had a similar condition, that they were made aware that they were entitled to any form of state support or assistance. This is a profoundly disabled child. We have to do better at making sure that families have an awareness of the support available to them. But as we've heard, there are many barriers and traps to people once they do get support. And throughout their lives in modern Scotland, they have to face tests, sanctions, and undignified and unfair testing regimes. We must form a progressive alliance across this chamber to unpick and dismantle these. And I congratulate the government for the work they did just immediately prior to the Scottish elections in terms of ending the manifestly unfair removal of the disability living allowance for children who went into hospital for protracted hospital stays. There was an assumption there that because your child is in hospital, you no longer have caring responsibility for them, when ask any carer just how manifestly untrue that absolutely is. And then finally, we need to talk about political rhetoric and how we marry that up with the actions that we as political classes take. Talk is often cheap in this area, and those affected, it is action that absolutely matters most. We can look right across the history of devolution to the fact that there are still people today fighting for justice after the contaminated blood disaster and recognition of the challenges that they still face. I think we are finally reaching a marriage between political rhetoric and reality there, but there is still a long way to go. In 2008, the Scottish Government In 2008, the UK government came up with a strategy for children with disabilities, aiming high for children with disabilities, and that was met with £36 million Barnett consequential that came north. Yet still, we are waiting for a strategy for children with disabilities. And indeed, we need to make sure our local authorities are delivering on their political realities in terms of the single outcome agreements they set, and so seldomly reference the needs of people with disabilities. So finally, I am grateful to colleagues from across this chamber for the respect they've shown each other, because we do everyone a disservice
who are
affected by disability.
Would you close, please, Mr.
Cole? And I applaud the government for bringing forward this motion. You can rest assured that the Liberal Democrats will support it. Thank you.
I call Marie Todd to be followed by Elaine Smith.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. For the past 20 years, I've worked as a clinical pharmacist specialising in psychiatry. Mental ill health is the leading cause of chronic illness, and it represents up to 23% of all ill health in the UK. It's the largest single cause of disability. Mental health problems often affect people of working age, and they're really common. We've heard before in this chamber that one in every four of us will suffer a diagnosable condition. One of the reasons that I came into politics is because I witnessed on a daily basis the unfair effect the welfare system was having on the patients I was working with. Medication can really help some of these illnesses, but no medication can overcome the effect of poverty or isolation. I've seen firsthand the effect of the Westminster attitude to welfare. I've seen a patient with treatment-resistant schizophrenia wrongly declared fit to work and consequently losing her benefits. I watched her try to cope with the threat of homelessness and the stress of the appeal process. And I watched her illness deteriorate to the point that she needed to be admitted to hospital for several months. It's a barbaric way to treat our most vulnerable citizens. And let me tell you, it's expensive. Inpatient care in a psychiatric hospital costs nearly £3,000 a week. That is truly a false economy. I have also worked with people who have attempted suicide because they lost all hope after losing their benefits. Any one of us here in this chamber would struggle to remain healthy if we felt we were the victim of blind economic forces beyond our control, or if we felt that we had no say in shaping or determining our destinies. Many people with mental health problems can work and want to work. We need to support them to work where they are able. However, the current welfare system does not do this. It's mistrusted, it causes anxiety, and it lacks sufficient flexibility to measure the impact of mental health conditions on a person's ability to sustain employment. This isn't just my opinion. There's now a substantial body of evidence which demonstrates that the welfare reforms introduced by the coalition government, let me say, in Westminster were not fit for purpose for people experiencing mental health problems. The Royal College of Psychiatrists, the Samaritans, and SAMH, along with many others, have all raised concerns. The devolution of parts of the social security system provides an excellent opportunity for us to redefine the narrative around what we want the system to achieve. We have to be clear that it should be about empowering citizens, facilitating participation, and recognising everyone's contribution and value to society. So what needs to change? The people undertaking assessments of an individual's ability to work have to have an adequate knowledge and understanding about mental health. We have to acknowledge that stress and anxiety are having an adverse effect on the mental health of those being assessed and reassessed and then reassessed again. Many people are being refused payments or are having their benefits cut or withdrawn only to have them reinstated on appeal. We have to make the system work more effectively, and we have to remove the fear factor. The patients that I worked with suffered a double stigma. Firstly, from having a mental health problem, and secondly, from being on benefits. We need a system of social security that doesn't stigmatise people or punish people who receive benefits. The assessment of an individual's ability to work has to be based on the person's day-to-day abilities and not on an isolated instance. One of the main criticisms of the current system is the lack of sensitivity to illnesses which vary in severity from day to day or week to week. We have to recognise that for some individuals with chronic illnesses where there's much less chance of a significant sustained improvement or even an ability to live independently, repeat assessments are unnecessary. Let's look at the evidence, let's work with the service users, and let's work with the professionals who work with them too to design much more effective policies and services. By working together, we can make sure we design a system which is better equipped to meet people's needs. The Scottish Government has a proven track record of taking action to protect the vulnerable through our commitment to universal services.
Sorry, can I ask the member to wind up very quickly?
Establishment of the Scottish Welfare Fund and ensuring no one in Scotland is impacted by the bedroom tax with dignity, fairness and respect.
No, must stop you there. Sorry, we're very tight for time. So call Elaine Smith, be followed by Maurice Corrie, Ms. Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I welcome the Minister to her role. In November 1942, the Beveridge Report was presented by its author, Sir William Beveridge, to the British Parliament. It provided a summary of principles necessary to banish poverty and want from Britain, and it proposed a system of social security which would be operated by the state. In 1945, Clement Attlee's Labour government announced the introduction of the welfare state as contained in that report, and this included the establishment of an NHS in 1948 with free medical treatment for all at the point of need. And a national system of benefits was also introduced to provide social security so that the population would be protected from the cradle to the grave. This then was the foundation of the modern welfare state, and those of us in the Labour Party are very proud of that. As the Minister said in her opening, I hope that we can have a Scottish social security system that we're also proud of, because I can't imagine that Clem Attlee or Nye Bevan, founder of the NHS, would have considered that some 70 years after their system to make people socially secure, we would have to debate dignity, fairness and respect in disability benefits. However, it's obvious that we do. Cuts to disability benefits are unfair, as pointed out in the government's motion, and they cause stress and financial hardship, which has a major impact on health and well-being. In researching her book, Kayleigh Garthwaite worked in a food bank, and she found that the impact of welfare reform was a major reason for people using food banks, along with issues like ill health, caring responsibilities and redundancy. And she gives an example of a food bank user, Martin, who shows how undignified people can feel on benefits and having to rely on food banks. He'd no electricity, so he couldn't afford to feed the meter, so he was given a box of cold foods. And when he was asked if he wanted tinned fish, he said, "Salmon on benefits. Don't let the government hear you giving out luxuries like that." Kayleigh points out how this shows the ingrained stigmatisation of people using food banks. Another example was a woman, Sally, who has ME, fibromyalgia and bipolar, and she had to use the food bank because of benefit changes. And she said, "Although the staff at the food bank are very respectful, being forced to use the food bank and having to rely on such little money has made me feel less of a human being. I wish the government would stop and realise we are human beings, not second-class citizens." Well, with the devolution of some benefits to this Parliament, specifically disability benefits, government here has the opportunity to treat people like human beings. And although much of what is said today, I think, could apply to the whole of social security, there is an emphasis in the motion on disability benefits, which definitely need a more sympathetic approach. As the Helpful Alliance briefing tells us, it's one that must be underpinned by a human rights approach, and that means a shift in perspective towards people who are entitled to benefits and a change in language used when referring to people. They also recommend advocacy support during the assessment process, and I'm pleased to note the Scottish Government intends to make assessments fair and transparent. Many people, particularly elderly, they don't get the benefits they're due because sometimes they don't know where to start applying, or they're too proud, or because they actually take no for an answer in the first place and they just don't appeal. So they need help to access what's rightfully theirs, and I think it's good the government has recognised this. So this Parliament now has the powers to do things differently, to treat people with kindness, compassion and respect. And the transfer of welfare powers and tax powers gives this Parliament the most power and responsibility it's had in its history. Over the years, I think these were the powers that were most often mentioned as the ones people wanted devolved. But to paraphrase my friend, the late Jimmy Reid, powers without principles, or indeed purposes, are hardly worth having. The people demanding those powers undoubtedly believed that if welfare and further taxpayers were devolved, then Scotland would make different, more compassionate choices to those of the Tories at Westminster. To do that, this government and Parliament needs to be ambitious and invest more in this sector. Just changing priorities will not be enough. In the Red Paper in Scotland 2014, Katie Clark points out that in Scotland, those choices that have already been taken on prescriptions, tuition fees and free personal care have simply been taken at the expense of other areas of social and welfare policy. The cake has been divided differently, perhaps, but has not been made bigger. Now, as members who know me will be aware, I supported all of those policies when it wasn't politically fashionable to do so. But I don't think we have to make choices between good policies. It was actually the norm in previous decades for any politician calling themselves left of centre to make the argument for progressive taxation on the understanding that to get decent public services and a fair society, we all need to pay fair tax. So if this Parliament is really to come of age, and if its makeup is really a majority left of centre, then I believe we must use the new tax powers to make the cake bigger so that we can provide dignity, fairness and respect in disability benefits and better public services. I'm going to finish with Nye Bevan, who said in Place of Fear, when talking about the NHS and welfare, and I quote, "To call it something for nothing is absurd because everything has to be paid for in some way or another. Unless it's taken from somewhere else in the public purse that can't afford to lose it, then a better, more just system of benefits and public services must be paid for, and I would suggest through fair and progressive taxation." Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Smith. I call Maurice Corry, to be followed by Christina McKelvey. Mr Corry.
Thank you. Deputy Presiding Officer, may I welcome the Minister in her new role. I wish to speak in this debate in respect to the Armed Forces servicemen and women and their needs for dignity, fairness and respect with reference to the welfare benefits system. Since World War II, we have seen our armed forces deployed overseas on several campaigns from Korea and Suez in the 1950s and onwards to the present day. Our men and women of the armed forces take up the call of duty as ordered, and they go to these theatres of operation in the knowledge that they could pay the ultimate sacrifice. Those who very sadly are killed on operations leave behind them loved ones and dependents whose lives have been turned upside down. This can be the same for those servicemen and women whose life-changing injuries have the same impact on loved ones and families and life ahead, and therefore the service person living with a disability. As you recall in my first speech in this chamber, I spoke about the Armed Forces Community Covenant and its purpose when it was implemented in May 2011. It is precisely the purposes of the Covenant, which is to help and support our sailors, soldiers and airmen and women, reservists and veterans who find themselves in the situations I have already described. The Covenant brings together our national government, our local authorities and our communities, and those serving in the armed forces and our veterans. In further looking at ensuring our serving armed forces personnel are fairly treated by the welfare system, there are varying levels of experience when they and our veterans are dealing with the social welfare benefits. Yes, I will.
I thank
Mr. Corrie for giving way, Presiding Officer. In his initial speech in this place, I responded by saying that the MOD itself could do more in terms of helping folks with mental health problems when they leave the armed forces. I think it's all fair and well that we have a social security system that deals with all cases, but I do think that the MOD itself has a role to play here, and I wonder if the member agrees with that.
I fully agree with that. And in fact, I have been dealing with that in my shadow post on that one. Various organisations who provide support to veterans in Scotland have experienced some issues which I've now highlighted. Veterans lack the knowledge generally about the welfare benefit system. Some of their civilian counterparts have a greater awareness of the system through family members being in receipt of benefits. There are areas, sadly, where some generations of families in Scotland have never had employment, very unfortunately, and as such understand the welfare system by need and how it helps them. Nevertheless, veterans are likely to have little specific awareness of the recent changes in the benefit system, such as PIP. Veterans are in the main very reluctant to seek assistance from the benefit system, citing a feeling of personal failure. Welfare benefit staff generally have a lack of awareness of the needs of the veteran client group. There are myths and misconceptions which abound about what a veteran is, following on from similar myths about what it is to be a member of Her Majesty's Armed Forces. Communicating with the welfare benefit staff can be difficult and frustrating for the veteran. There is evidence that despite having consent of the veteran, the welfare benefit staff will not discuss a client without a client being present. Veterans frequently comment that having served their country, they feel the welfare benefit system does not take cognizance of the service and the military covenant. Many of these points can be evidenced through organisations such as Glasgow Helping Heroes, Veterans Scotland, SAFA, Shelter Scotland, Scotland's Veterans Residence, and Erskine and Legion Scotland, to name but a few. And my research and experience has shown over the last few years since the implementation of the Military Covenant in 2011 that several key elements of welfare benefits are now firmly in place for our armed forces, serving personnel and veterans. And these are such things as child benefits, statutory sick pay, Armed Forces Independence Payment, PIP, Sure Start Maternity Grant, Job Allowances, Tax Credits, Childcare Costs, Council Tax Relief when on military operations and social housing. In respect to this last point, the benefit of social housing allocation, it took some considerable time to bring fairness to our Armed Forces personnel when they leave the services and their Ministry of Defence House. For many years, there was no recognition of many years of living in MOD housing by local authorities and housing associations, and therefore our armed forces personnel went to the bottom of the pile, for they did not have enough points on the housing ladder. Realising this unfairness here, and I take the point of the gentleman, that the UK government encouraged change to this with local authorities, and in this case, there is now a recognition of the time spent in Ministry of Defence housing, so it's on parity with civilian housing. Since the implementation of the Military Covenant 2011 in the UK, signed nonetheless by a Conservative Prime Minister, things have come a long way for Armed Forces men and women and the 260,000 veterans now resident in Scotland. Nevertheless, there are still some way to go yet to reach the levels of recognition support we see for veterans in the USA, Canada and some Western European countries. And we can achieve this in Scotland, I am sure. And to get there, we must build on the successes so far by listening to the needs of our Armed Forces services, men and women and our veterans throughout Scotland for dignity, fairness and respect in our welfare benefit system for them. Thank you.
The member to stop right there. That's a good place to stop. Thank you. I now call Christina McKelvey to be followed by Claire Adamson. Ms. McKelvey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Under the Human Rights Act 1998 and the European Convention of Human Rights, disabled people have a right to be treated with dignity and respect. Now, that's a fundamental right. The UK and the Scottish Government also have a duty to progressively realise these rights contained in the UN Convention of the Rights of Disabled People, which includes the rights to adequate income and to be fully included in social and community life. That means the right to safety, security, and the right to live life, or, in some cases, what's left of that life, free from the worry of being able to afford to heat or eat. Now, Inclusion Scotland tells us, and I thank them for their briefing, that disabled people are being robbed of their dignity and respect, and adequate income, and sometimes even their lives by the current benefit system. Sanctions are being imposed unfairly and disproportionately on disabled people, especially those with learning disabilities and mental health issues. And a combination of welfare reforms, the work capability assessment, mandatory reconsideration, and sanctions are pushing an increasing number of disabled people into poverty and destitution. And one in five GISA sanctions are applied against disabled people. Now, let's look at one aspect of the current regime, PIP. And Mr. Tompkins attempted to convince us that PIP was working well. So here's the reality for a current claimant this week. A person with motor neuron disease has been asked to undertake his PIP assessment, reassessment, by questionnaire over a year in advance of the date his current claim ends. So let's not forget, the prognosis for someone with motor neuron disease is 14 very short months. So he received a questionnaire in February this year, when the award runs until May 2017, a whole 15 months away. 15 months, when you may only have 14 months left of your life, and much of that with decreasing quality and independence. Renewal forms usually go out between 3 and 6 months before the renewal date, so what's this all about? He's been asked on the questionnaire to state how his disability affects him now. Now, anybody that knows motor neuron disease will know that the rapid progression of it, you can change from day to day, but you progressively always get worse. This assessment would give a snapshot of the illness as it is now and would have little bearing on how the illness progresses or how it might be affecting him next May, should he actually make it till then. This has caused stress and anxiety for this gentleman, who could be given a lower award of PIP than he might actually require next year. So he would need to be reassessed again. That stress and anxiety could rob him of his confidence and, more importantly, the precious little time he has left. He was also made aware that he could be called up to face reassessment. Not only the stress of all of this, but a reassessment. So this gentleman contacted the Motor Neuron Disease Scotland Welfare and Benefits Officer, and after much to-ing and fro-ing and stress and anxiety, they managed to resolve the situation just recently. Should he have needed to go through that whole process? I say no, he shouldn't have. The stress that he's been through in trying to deal with the DWP and get a common sense approach to his renewal process has had an adverse impact on his life, and is neither a fair nor dignified way to deal with people who have a terminal progressive illness. Mr. Tompkins.
Well, Christina McKelvey, for the reasons that she's outlined in her speech, therefore support the Scottish Conservatives in pressing the Scottish Government to transfer these powers to this Parliament as soon as possible.
I think the committee that dealt with the devolution of powers did that very well on their own. What we need is the budgets to transfer with them. So you take your part in the process and I'll take my part in the process. But I agree with Motor Neuron Disease Scotland, who believes that people with the illness should be exempt from assessment, as used to happen under the incapacity benefit, which predated employment support allowance. I also agree with Motor Neuron Disease Scotland that as long as a PIP is in place, people with MND should receive a lifetime award of higher level PIPs so they do not need to contend with a new renewal process in the first place. Presiding Officer, next week I will be hosting an MND exhibition. I suggest Mr. Tompkins and his colleagues go and speak to the people who will be there, and he'll maybe get a better picture. So if we truly want to ensure that we put dignity and respect at the heart of this new system, we need to ensure as quickly as possible that we protect people with MND and other life-limiting disabilities from a culture of a system that does not treat them with dignity and respect. And I believe this government has and will do that, and that with early talks, the people affected will ensure that this government will live up to that promise.
Thank you very much. Claire Adamson, followed by Alec Johnson. Claire Adamson, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I had the pleasure this week of attending Lanarkshire Carers Together AGM on Monday, where they had a fantastic event with only over 250 attendees, many, many of whom were carers from across the North Lanarkshire area. It's a fantastic organisation. It is under the chair of Elizabeth Seaton, who has been a formidable, tireless and passionate campaigner for many years for carers, born out of her own caring responsibilities. It has been going since 2001, when it was formally constituted, and has contributed hugely to the lives of carers in my area. It's a force for change. It has raised the profile of carers' issues. It influences policy decisions at local level and also on a national level. And they really do make a difference every day for carers in my area. We have a massive, massive effort ahead in making this work. Increasing carers' allowance by £600 a year, 18% to them, will make a huge difference to the life of carers. And I hugely welcome the initiative about young carers' allowances, and I look forward to seeing the progress of that going forward. And we have done so much with the carers' bill, the right to a carers' assessment being instituted in law, and also in looking at things like the 84-day rule, which will be abolished by this government. But we do have a huge task ahead, and it will rely on working in conjunction with the UK government. And we still have issues that were discussed at the time of the bill that remain to be seen to work, like local eligibility criteria not leading to a postcode lottery of how this is developed in the future. I've been fascinated by some of the contributions this afternoon, Presiding Officer. Can I say Marie Todd's contribution as a mental health professional has been absolutely wonderful to inform the whole chamber of these issues. Enable Scotland, in their submission, said that they feel that the specific medical assessment is rarely the best way to assess a claimant's disability, and that in fact particularly unsuited to assessing those with learning disability who can be particularly vulnerable to negative decisions in any process which involves communicating their disability. Benefit-specific medical assessments tend to produce a snapshot of a claimant's life rather than the long-term picture, and how many conditions could that apply to? Such have been mentioned by George Adam with MS, by MND, with people with chronic pain and mental health conditions. And we really have to get this right and not continue down the line where a snapshot defines a person's future and their economic condition. I can understand very much why the Tories want to draw a line under their history. If I was a Tory, I'd want to draw a line under that history and forget about it too. But unfortunately, life's not like that. And the language of shirkers and strivers that was mentioned by Jan Lamont and other people this afternoon is not new. And I'm old enough to remember Peter Lilly's appalling address to the 1992 Conservative Party conference, where he absolutely attacked the benefit system. So this afternoon, Presiding Officer, I'd like to say that I have a little list. And it's a list of Tory austerity practices that this SNP government will be rooting out. And they won't be missed. So repeat assessments of terminally ill patients should go, as described by the Minister, as a revolving door of reassessment. The remote assessment centres, as mentioned by my colleague Gillian Martin, absolutely make life so much more difficult for people. Meaningless assessment criteria for conditions that with fluctuating conditions that have already been mentioned today as well. Assessments that leave people leaving humiliated and threatened in their lives. Mandatory reconsideration before appeals can happen that just delay the whole process and put people into economic and emotional turmoil. Ignoring expert medical opinion, why on earth would we not listen to our GPs and the people that know patients and know clients better than anyone else? Oh yes, I have a little list, Presiding Officer, and I trust that this SNP government will not miss a single one.
Thank you very much. I call Alec Johnson, followed by Neil Findlay. Mr. Johnson.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. During the last full five-year term of this Parliament, welfare-related issues rose up the agenda quickly, and by the end of the last Parliament, they were right there near the very top. And much of the debate that happened during that 5 years was characterised by what can best be described as an unedifying scramble for the moral high ground, because it was an easy target with which to hit a Conservative government. And in the opening speeches in this debate, we heard once again how it was Conservative welfare reform that apparently drove this issue. Yet the reality is, if we look back, the welfare reform programme started before there was a Conservative government. In fact, it was necessary going back a generation. And the first great attempt to reform welfare actually happened when Frank Field was the welfare minister back in 2007. Perhaps you'd notice on the graphs that that was the last time sanctions reached a peak. The reality is, however, that the Conservatives in this Parliament have done and continue to take a constructive and engaged approach. A number of speakers, Kevin Stewart, Joanne Lamont and Claire Adamson, have chosen to introduce what I could best describe as pejorative language in an attempt to denigrate the Conservatives and their position. But I can assure you that they have not heard that language from us in this chamber, and they will not. And it is a tribute to the work that's been done by people. No, I will not give way. It is a tribute to the work that has been done by people on this side of the chamber that we will not go down that road. And it is other speakers who have to introduce that language in order to support their own arguments. The truth is that we have a different attitude, but we are the party that in government, and yes, I will claim credit for what happened in Westminster with the devolution of these powers over welfare for the disabled in the Scotland Bill to this Parliament. We have a tremendous opportunity, but there are dangers of which we must be aware. Over the last 5 years, Over the last 5 years, we have seen the gradual transfer of some welfare powers. The welfare funds, for example, when the schemes were wound up and replaced by alternative schemes, there was a widespread view that these schemes had been abolished and the money was no longer available, when in fact the schemes existed under a different form and the money was still available, yet people were unaware of them. As we make changes, we must be careful not to change too quickly. There are good signs that PIP is working. And we've heard today from my colleague Jeremy Balfour about his experience of that scheme. We've also heard that additional resources moving in to a number of other areas. And while though some in the chamber seek to portray these as cuts, the truth is that the money is actually increasing in many areas. We need to work together constructively, and I'm delighted that so many people in this debate have sought to engage constructively. I hope that's a change of direction and one which we can take forward, because I agree with the statement that was made by Jean Freeman at the very start of this debate, that we need a social security system that we can all be proud of, and that thanks to the decision to devolve powers over disability benefits, it can take a different path from the rest of the UK. That opportunity is one we should grasp, and one that during this next 5 year period of government, we must have the courage to work together on. There are also those in this debate who have asked for further devolution of welfare responsibilities. Those who would like to see the devolution of pensions, for example, must actually start telling us how they might go about paying for their promises should they ever come to that conclusion. But we must be courageous. We in this side of the chamber have new faces, we have new ideas, and we have new energy to take forward into this. I hope this government will show maturity, greater than that shown by some others and some of their backbenchers, by realising that there is an opportunity to put the past behind us and make things better for the people who require our support.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Johnson. I call Neil Findlay, followed by Ben McPherson. Mr. McPherson will be the last speaker. Mr. Findlay.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. I think this debate is key to how we see ourselves as a society. It's a cliche to say that we judge a society by how it treats its most vulnerable people, but just because it's a cliche doesn't mean there is no truth in it. The current UK government most certainly isn't caring compassionately for our disabled neighbours, our friends, our relatives, low-income families, the elderly, the vulnerable or the needy. 100,000 Scottish disabled people have lost out as a result of ideologically driven cuts to disability benefits. Hundreds of thousands of low-income families across the UK, many of them working families but poor as a result of low pay and wage restraint, have been affected by cuts to housing and tax credits. There is a big list of social security cuts that have been introduced by Cameron and Osborne since 2010. Child trust funds abolished, in England EMA abolished, working and child tax credits reduced, health and pregnancy grant gone, housing benefits cuts, child benefit frozen and ended for some claimants, council tax benefits cuts, DLA replaced by PIP, saving £1 billion a year, and of course the grotesque bedroom tax. The list goes on and on and on. Over 40 benefits cut, all benefits for lone parents, the disabled and families, affecting the poor, poorest, the most needy people in our communities most. And what I find offensive about all of that is the relish and glee with which it has been done. Time after time, as Osborne has announced his latest budgetary assault on the welfare state, we've witnessed Tory MPs cheering and braying as they condemn another family to the food bank, another young person to a future devoid of hope and opportunity, or another disabled person is stripped of the mobility card that is their link to the outside world. And I find it truly sickening to see a Prime Minister and a Chancellor in a cabinet of millionaires with an estimated combined wealth of £100 million cutting their own taxes and those of their friends in the corporate world, whilst at the same time removing, removing the safety net from those in most need of our help. Presiding Officer, this Parliament was not established to be a conveyor belt for bad policy, no matter where and from whom it emanates. In the last Parliament, a Labour member's bill on the bedroom tax forced the government to act. That shows what we can do when there is the political will to act. So with the new powers coming over a number of areas of social security, we have the opportunity to do things very different. Having sat in the Welfare Reform Committee in the last session, I think there is a large majority in this Parliament that supports the creation of a more humane, fairer, supportive social security system that's designed to help people into employment and to support those who, for whatever reason, are unable to work, to support them in their lives. And to get away from a system based on suspicion, a system based on the language that Joanne Lamont mentioned of strivers and skivers, based on a set of political beliefs that sees the state in some particular kind of tyrannical, as some particular tyrannical enemy of freedom. That's how the Tories see this. According to that philosophy, the welfare state is a barrier to the operation of the free market. It intervenes in the economy and the labour market, attempts to universalise life chances, and heaven forbid, it redistributes wealth. Presiding Officer, it's that ethos that has underpinned the Tory attack on the social security system. And the Tory motion and the Tory speakers today have not acknowledged the untold misery that they have inflicted upon people. 2,500 people have died after being declared fit for work. Not a word of remorse from Mr. Tompkins, or how would we ever expect a word of remorse from Mr. Johnson? Presiding Officer, let us build a different system, one that supports the army of carers who look after their family and friends. And let's not celebrate the fact that we'll increase carers' allowance to JSA. That will hardly have people living a life of luxury. That should be the minimum we're providing. We should be looking to move on much further as the system develops. Let's see a system that allows disabled people to live fulfilling, independent lives, helped, not hindered by the system, and a system that provides a safety net so that any of us who require it can be helped by it. We have the chance to do that, and it will be a test for all of us who claim to be progressives, whether we want to take that chance or not.
Thank you very much, Mr. Finlay. We'll call Ben McPherson, then we move to winding up speeches.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In Carers Week, I would also like to take this opportunity to express my thanks and deep admiration for carers across Scotland, and in particular to those in my own constituency, from the work of the North West Carers Centre in the north of this city to Cornerstones in Your Corner initiative supporting young adult carers in North East Edinburgh. Furthermore, Presiding Officer, I'd also like to pay tribute to the remarkable third sector organisations across Scotland who are working day in, day out to help mitigate the negative impacts of UK government welfare reform. Organisations like the Citizens Advice Bureau in Leith, which I visited on Monday, or the Grant and Information Centre in my constituency. Presiding Officer, behind the wording of the government motion, there is a fundamental question, a question focused on how we can support the weakest members of our society better through different, wiser, and more compassionate choices than the current UK government, where and when this Parliament has the power. Presiding Officer, when it comes to assisting those who need our assistance most, last week Adam Tonkins made the valid point that while Westminster sets the floor with new powers in this Parliament, we will soon have some opportunity, in Mr. Tompkins' words, to raise the ceiling. However, the challenge for us here in Scotland, which Mr. Tompkins didn't mention, is not just how we improve our social security system, but also how we do so with only 15% of social security powers, and how do we make progress from a financial and policy position where the floor that Westminster sets, to use Adam Tompkins' analogy, is steadily falling, cut by cut and year by year. Presiding Officer, the circumstances facing the most vulnerable in our society are, of course, difficult and challenging. And so the role of government should surely be to assist them, not to judge. It should surely be to support, not to distress. And it is for these reasons that I believe in the Scottish Government's commitment, outlined by the Minister, to create a social security system with dignity and respect at its heart, to use new powers to make a meaningful difference. And I particularly support the Scottish Government's proposals to ensure that disability benefits are not means-tested and instead that assessments are fair and transparent. Because, Presiding Officer, at the moment, the UK Government's cuts to disability benefits are often unfair and they have caused unnecessary and unacceptable stress and financial hardship. For example, as Sandra White alluded to, 98% of relevant respondents to a survey by SAMH revealed that the mental health of service users had suffered due to welfare reform. To use another example, Inclusion Scotland's research has revealed that 45% of disabled people with mobility vehicles are losing their cars on transfer to PIP. Presiding Officer, I make these points not just based on reporting and analysis, but also on the experience of many of my constituents, constituents who have contacted me since I was elected in states of unnecessary distress, discomfort, and genuine suffering, particularly due to the assessment process for PIP. For example, one constituent wrote to me recently about being transferred from DLA to PIP with a significant reduction in their award for mobility. They wrote, "This has turned my life upside down. I'm now at the point where I have to go to appeal, and quite honestly, I'm not sure how much fight I have left. This has just floored me. It's like having my legs taken away. Help." Presiding Officer, this and other concerns that, in similar words that I'm sure other members have received since being elected, are upsetting accounts. And what's more upsetting is that they are just some of many similar stories throughout those affected across Scotland. Presiding Officer, the current UK government's approach to social security has too often caused instances of injustice, it has lacked generosity, and it has been frequently mean-spirited. And that is why this Parliament must and will make different and better choices with the social security powers coming to this institution, as outlined by the Minister earlier. Presiding Officer, I welcome the Scottish Government's commitment to dignity, fairness and respect in disability benefits. And I look forward to the positive change that lies ahead.
Thank you very much, Mr McPherson. Now move to winding up speeches. Polly McNeill for Labour, 6 minutes or thereabouts.
Presiding Officer, Carers Week, as we recognise the selfless and necessary role that carers play in society, but more importantly, to show the action that we can take in this Parliament. As the Minister, Jean Freeman, says, the goal to have a life alongside caring, I think, is where we need to be. I think it is testament to the hard work of the carers groups that carers have a high priority for this Parliament in its agenda. As we know, Carers Week also reminds us that without carers, our society simply could not function, and that any one of us may be called upon to be carers at any point in our lives. But the main purpose of the motion for debate is to ensure dignity and respect in our social security system, which should be the heart of a fairer Scotland. So Adam Tompkins says that no one, no party, should have a monopoly to bring that to the table, and I agree. It is the ground on which the new Scottish social security system should be founded, as Ben McPherson and others have said, to take it in a new direction. But there is anger out there and in here about the fact that aspects of our welfare system to date have not given people, and disabled people in particular, a dignified life. In fact, I, as a citizen, felt that from 2012, on the back of the austerity measures, I've never actually felt so angry as I did watching the reforms and cuts to benefits and the powerless. But it wasn't simply just that it was an attack on the living standards by a reduction in benefits and allowances, but the very system itself, as others have alluded to, the system has left many vulnerable people in despair. And Marie Todd made an excellent speech where she says it gave people no say in determining their own destiny. And in some ways, that is worse than a financial cut. That feeling that you can do nothing. In some other societies around the world, it's these conditions that have led to revolution and the overthrow of governments. But in many ways too, perhaps, we have the opportunity to have our own quiet revolution to change what has been, to some extent, an inhumane system. Christina McKelvey rightly quotes an excellent brief by Inclusion Scotland, where they say that disabled people have been robbed of their dignity. There's many stark figures in there. The 1 in 5 figure that Christina quotes about job seekers allowing sanctions against disabled people is really quite shocking. But there is nothing dignified about some aspects of our current system, as Neil Findlay talks about. Work capability assessments and the so-called appeals system, where has it not occurred to the person who designed that system that if you then have to wait for the very benefit that you've applied for, how are you meant to live in the weeks in between? 60% of employment support allowance sanctions are against claimants with mental and behavioural disorders. I certainly will.
Mr. Tompkins.
Does the member recognise that the employment and support allowance was introduced not by the Conservatives but by the last Labour government, and indeed that it was the last Labour government that signed the contract with ATOS to undertake the work capability assessments?
Well, the criteria changed, and Mr. Tompkins and also Mr. Johnson, well, I'll get to the point where you are the people from that side of the chamber who want to come and have some consensus about this debate. I think there is much for you to defend here, because there are huge financial losses, and I did not hear one word from the Tory benches about the thousands of people who will lose out in the transfer to PIP. Inclusion Scotland say that 47% of DLA claimants with awards on the higher rate mobility will lose their entitlement to the enhanced rate when they are reassessed. What do you have to say about the 45% of disabled people with mobility vehicles who are losing their cars? I do think that we need to have a discussion with ministers and the new Social Security Committee about the transitional arrangements, because by the time that we have the powers, a lot of these transfers will have taken place. Joanne Lamont, I think, makes a crucial point in this debate, which is perhaps the greater scandal about not enough action for overcoming the barriers to disabled people coming into employment. And the figures that she quotes on modern apprenticeships is a scandal and something this Parliament does need to address. I think that would be real progress if we could make progress here in giving dignity and respect. Achieving your full potential should be a phrase that means something to every single person. Alison Johnson talks about the new powers, presiding officer, and I'll wind up. She talks that we get these powers at a crucial time, and we have a chance to design a new system that will put that dignity back. And I do think we can work cross-party to achieve that, and this Parliament will show that it has the powers it can do something with. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms McNeill. I call Annie Wells to sum up the Conservatives, 8 minutes, up to 8 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Firstly, I would like to congratulate Jean Freeman on her appointment today, and also her maiden speech, which was very good, and also that of Jeremy Balfour. I'm glad to have the opportunity to close the debate today. As a new welfare reform and equality spokesperson for the Scottish Conservative Party, I would like to add my thanks and support for the Carers Week as well, which is currently taking place up and down the country, and to make a personal thank you to the many carers who provide an invaluable service to families and communities in Scotland. I am very proud of the Scottish Conservatives' manifesto pledge to bring carers' allowance in line with job seekers' allowance, a move that will support over 60,000 carers in Scotland, and I welcome the Scottish Government's commitment to implement the proposal. With £1.5 billion worth of spending being devolved to the Scottish Parliament, that is the entirety of the Disability Living Allowance or Personal Independence Allowance in full. I want to point out that it's now in the hands of the Scottish Government to ensure that it is responsible for delivering the new system of disability benefits. As I said in the debate last week, it is clear that with these new powers, blaming the UK Government is no longer appropriate or indeed acceptable. The devolution of these powers to Scotland allows us all to have a rigorous discussion about how we support some of the most vulnerable people in our society. Again, part of the reason why the issue is so important is that if we don't design Scotland's social security system properly, we will be letting down the most vulnerable in our society. As Adam Tomkins pointed out in his speech, we want to see our social security system with some basic principles at its heart. It should primarily support the most vulnerable in our society. It should be flexible and personalised, and it should give those who can and want to work the opportunities and support to do just that. We should start this process with a positive outlook and how we should not imply things that are untrue about the current system. For example, the disability benefits are currently means-tested under the UK Government. Creating this confusion is not helpful for anyone and serves only to score political points. As Jeremy Balfour pointed out in his speech, whilst there are problems, PIP in its essence is a constructive system and it is a marked improvement over the DLA. And as Adam Tomkins points out, benefits related to the additional costs of disability have been increased every year. Constructive innovation, that's what we're asking for, not a complete upheaval. Any social security system worth its salt should serve to support the most vulnerable in society. If an individual is unable to work, then it is fundamentally important that our social security system is able to support them in a fair, dignified and respectful manner at all times. I believe that it is necessary to make the measure to ensure that our social security system is personalised, responsive and flexible. It is, of course, important that the needs of the individual should always be borne in mind, and an effective and efficient social security system should be able to respond to differing and often complex personal circumstances. We should do our best to ensure that the administrative burden of our social security system is not overly burdensome. Similarly, we should be mindful that Scotland's social security system does not simply involve a revolving door of assessments and paperwork, as well as making us better use of medical evidence and information sharing. We too want innovation. As Liam Kerr pointed out, the Scottish Conservatives have our own vision and we all must look to the future. And I also welcome Maurice Corrie's insight. Yeah?
Minister?
Will the member accept that in the context where we have 15% of the benefit powers devolved to us and 85% remain at Westminster, the reality is not that we're looking to the past, but we're looking to the present, and that if the member really does want assistance for those who want to go into employment, then she and her colleagues will turn to the UK government, of which you are so proud, and remind them not to cut benefits and support to long-term unemployed and people with disabilities who want to be unemployed, and stop trying to believe and make us believe that somehow we are the backward-looking ones and you are forward-looking. Far from the truth.
There is top-up benefits that this government will have control over as well. So I think we need to work together. That's what I'm trying to say here. We work together in this chamber to deliver the best for the people of Scotland. We should be mindful that Scotland's Social Security... No, I've done that. See, you got me out there. For instance, with the integration of health and social care, we should explore whether attendance allowance and DLA and PIP should be part of a similarly integrated system, either by devolving further control to local authorities' health boards or to the new health and social care partnerships. Indeed, on this subject, the Convention of Scottish Local Authorities has said full devolution of the disability and carers' benefits to Scottish local authorities could be used to develop more rounded personal budgets to enhance health and well-being and improve personal independence. This option could allow a more localised, personalised and flexible disability benefit system. I instinctively believe that the decisions are best taken as close to those who are affected as possible. Such innovations could result in not only a more effective social security system, but a fairer and more engaged one as well. One which focuses on looking at people as individuals, rather than just focusing on physical abilities. In short, we should work to ensure that people are supported to achieve personal independence holistically. This again brings me to an important point. In striving for dignity and personal independence for disabled people, we should always strive to help those who can and want to work into employment. It is also the case that for an individual to be supported to find work and for that individual to be working and contributing to society is surely also a dignified and fair outcome. I welcome Joanne Lamont's comments during her speech about supporting the people getting into work and keeping them in work. When thinking about fairness in relation to people who have a disability, I would ask, is it fair that the employment rates for disabled people are currently 43% lower than that of those not classed as disabled? I would say, of course it's not. And it's clear to me that we need to do more to help those who are looking for work, whether it's in terms of developing skills and boosting confidence, or a more practical support and advice. It is vital that the support is ready and available for those people who are looking for work. Many disabled people can work and want to work, and need some support to get into work. I am wholeheartedly committed to ensuring that all disabled people who want to work have the opportunity and support they need to get and keep a job. The words dignity and respect, to me, imply empowerment and opportunity as much as protection and security. In short, we have two core aims when it comes to the disability benefits system. We want to be supportive of those who cannot work, and we want to be effective at helping those who want to work. Again, I welcome, in line with our own policy, the proposed plan to increase the carers' allowance. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Cabinet Secretary, to wind up for the government, you have till 5 o'clock, up to 5 o'clock.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to start by congratulating Jeremy Balfour on his maiden speech. I listened to it with interest, particularly the parts about his experience as a serving member of the tribunal. I just hope the Tories have had the good sense to place him on the Social Security Committee. But, Presiding Officer, I want to start by talking about mental health and mental illness. It's been a feature of this debate today. Sandra White has spoken about it, and Marie Todd very powerfully has spoken about the impact of hopelessness and what that does to people's mental health. But mental health issues have also been a thread throughout many of the debates that we've had over the past few weeks as we've began this new parliamentary session, not least thanks to Alex Cole Hamilton. And as a consequence, Presiding Officer, I've been recalling the words of my old social work boss, who was trying to support and comfort me as a newly qualified mental health officer when a young woman that I had been working with had later went on to commit suicide. And I remember him saying, "Angela, you have to remember that mental illness is sometimes terminal." And what he meant is that mental illness, like physical illness, can be life-limiting and at times fatal. But with mental illness, it can be invisible. And there are people who are going about their daily life, going about their business in our community day by day, week by week, and we don't see or understand the invisible turmoil and torment that they go through as a result of a wide range of mental health issues. And I mention this, Presiding Officer, because for anyone who works with or for people with vulnerabilities or difficulties of any description, and for those of us who are charged with the responsibility to design, build, provide, and to provide a new service such as the Scottish Social Security Agency, the largest scale project in the history of this Parliament. And this is where I agree with Mark Griffin. We will have to have the insight, understanding, and the humility to know how hard we are all going to have to work to get this right and to get it right from the start. Because dignity, fairness, and respect will be built in with the bricks of the new agency. And Joanne Lamont was right, this has to be more than warm words. And we will proceed in that spirit of co-production, working with those with the lived experience of the benefit system. And we will at all times think about how it feels when the person doing the assessment wants to examine your stomach, when the problem is you can't get up out of your bed in the morning for due to crying constantly due to depression. Or how it feels when you read a report written about you and you are described as it. So we shouldn't underestimate the value and how we will need to ensure that the correct culture and the correct values are at the heart of this new agency. And Mr. Tomkins spoke about timescales, and make no mistake about it, Presiding Officer, yes, we want these new powers as soon as is practical. Indeed, we wanted more powers, and we want to be making different choices. But our number one priority, our number one responsibility, has to be the safe and secure transfer. And that means that we have to work as part of the Joint Ministerial Working Group on Welfare to ensure that the powers and resources are transferred and they're transferred appropriately. And I hope Mr. Tomkins is relieved that I did receive his letter and an acknowledgement was sent to him yesterday. But I can tell him that the Joint Ministerial Working Group on Welfare will, for the first time after the election, meet next week. And I've had constructive discussions both with David Mundell and Stephen Crabb. But I have to emphasise the practicalities here. Folk rely on their benefits, and we won't be gestured or bullied into unrealistic timescales despite our eagerness. We have to get this right. Certainly.
I'm very
Mr.
grateful.
Tomkins.
I'm very grateful to Angela Constance for giving way. Could the Cabinet Secretary give even a hint of a suggestion as to the sort of timetable in terms of, you know, actual months and years when we can expect these powers to be transferred to this Parliament?
Well, as Mr. Tomkins, I think, actually acknowledged in his letter to me, that the implementation dates for welfare will be agreed by the Joint Ministerial Working Group on Welfare. And as he also knows that this government will be undertaking over the summer months a pre-legislative consultation on the new Scottish Social Security Agency. So we are proceeding with a wealth of work. It is detailed work. We will proceed as fast as we can, but with great care and cautious, because we will not compromise this getting it right, because people depend on us and they depend on receiving the right benefit at the right time for the right amount. And if I can turn my attention just briefly to the Conservative motion. Many members have picked up on the fact that the Conservatives have conflated some of the issues in and around disability with employment, and how that covertly feeds into a nasty narrative that is about the deserving and undeserving poor. And we have to remember that we don't have all the powers in terms of supporting people into work. And I regret that deeply, and we will ensure that we use the powers that we do have to maximum impact. But it would be remiss of me not to reiterate that before employment services were devolved, that they did receive a whopping 87% cut before the powers and resources were transferred. And we have to question the Conservatives on some of their practices, because now 100% of the welfare state remains with them. When we get the new powers, we indeed will have 15%. And we have to question, how does losing your motability vehicle help you get to work? And that makes a sham of their claim to be ambitious about reducing the disability employment gap. Or how does it help people, making them fight for what should be theirs by right? How does that increase their confidence and insist them into the workplace? Presiding Officer, we will continue to oppose all attacks to Social Security for disabled people from the UK government. And it is imperative that expenditure is protected, not just for the benefits that are to be devolved to Scotland, but for also for those benefits that will remain reserved. And that includes ESA. And we've heard Tories today appeal against those unwarranted attacks on Westminster. And like Pauline McNeill, what about the unwarranted attacks on the poor? I haven't heard any Tory member today stand up for the poorest in our society. Because we have to remember that £6 billion has been taken from welfare expenditure in Scotland, and £1 billion of that is from our children. And we've heard today an appeal for consensus. Well, if Mr. Tompkins thinks that he can come to this chamber and appeal for consensus when they're cutting £30 a week for employment support agency, or to defend a sanction system that is not fit for purpose, to quote an infamous Tory, he can get on his bike. And if they were really serious about consensus, they would be voting with the far more progressive voices on a range of benches tonight. They would be voting against the £12 billion of cuts that have still to come. £12 billion of cuts on top of the £21 billion already taken out of welfare, the length and breadth of the UK. And finally, Presiding Officer, I know the Tories like to vote no, so why don't they vote with us tonight and vote no, stand up to Westminster, and along with the rest of this chamber, vote no to welfare cuts.
Thank you. That concludes our debate on dignity, fairness and respect in disability benefits. And the next item of business is decision time, to which we now come. There are three questions to be put as a result of today's business. And I wish to remind members that if the amendment in the name of Adam Thompsons is agreed, then the amendment in the name of Mark Griffin falls. So the first question is that amendment 374.2 in the name of Adam Tompkins, which seeks to amend motion 374 in the name of Angela Constance on dignity, fairness and respect in disability benefits, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There shall be a vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote is as follows. Yes, 29, no, 88, and there were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. The next question is that amendment 374.3 in the name of Mark Griffin, which seeks to amend motion 374 in the name of Angela Constance, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed. We shall therefore move to a vote. Members should cast their votes now. And the result of the vote is as follows. Yes, 88, no, 29, there were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore agreed. And the next question is that motion 374 in the name of Angela Constance, as amended, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed. There should be a vote. Members should cast their votes now. And the result of the vote is as follows. Yes, 88, no, 29, there were no abstentions. The motion as amended is therefore agreed. That concludes decision time, and I now close this meeting of Parliament.